Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to our service of worship. We trust the Lord will bless us as we worship together in the name of our Saviour, the Lord Jesus. There are just a few announcements. So just a reminder that our Zoom midweek meeting is 8:30 this Wednesday. It's Zoom only, so because of the restrictions. So if you want to join us for the first time via Zoom, you can do that. Just you know, we can give you help to do that, and just contact me and we'll give you whatever assistance you need for that. Next Sunday, our worship will again be online, and I hope to have the service uploaded to YouTube by between 11 and 11:30. And we trust and pray that we will be back in our buildings again after not too long, and hopefully after this 2 week period. So I want to read a portion of scripture just as our call to worship, and I usually read a psalm, but this is from the prophet Jeremiah, and it's Jeremiah, it's a well-known passage from Jeremiah, Jeremiah 31 and verses 33 to 34. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each one teach his neighbour and each his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. Amen. That's Jeremiah speaking of the new covenant, prophesying the new covenant that was to be established by God through Christ, and which we are the beneficiaries of in this church age through the gospel. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this opportunity just to worship you, to come into your presence. And we come into your presence now, Lord God, to acknowledge that you are the God of life, the God of salvation, the God of hope and of blessing. And we are in your presence. We come into your presence as those who worship you through and because of the great love that you have shown to us in Jesus our Saviour, and the salvation that you have wrought for us in Christ. For you, Heavenly Father, have loved us such that you have sent your only begotten Son to die for our sins, to pay the price of our sin on the cross, and to bring us redemption from sin and judgment and new life. And Lord God, as we worship together, even though we cannot meet together in our buildings, you unite us with the presence and by the presence of your Holy Spirit with each one of us, and we praise you for that. And we pray, Lord God, that you would help us to focus our hearts and our minds on you, that we would truly worship and honor you. We acknowledge, Lord God, our sin before you. We pray, Heavenly Father, for forgiveness for all of our transgressions, and that you would, through the help and presence of your Holy Spirit, enable us to live lives of holiness and purity in your presence, Lord, before you. Lives that are lived in sincerity and humility, and which are orderly before those who are around us in the world about us, that we may give glory to Christ our Saviour. Be with us for the remainder of this worship, we pray, and so we ask these things, Lord God, through and in the name of Jesus our Saviour. Amen. Go to worship the Lord now, and we're going to sing a well-known hymn, Name of All Majesty. So let's worship the Lord. Our scripture reading is 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 9 to 12, and it's read to us by Ian Bingham.
Today's reading is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 9 to 12. Now, about brotherly love, we do not need to write to you, for you yourselves have been taught by God to love each other. And in fact, you do love all the brothers throughout Macedonia. Yet, we urge you, brothers, to do so more and more. Make it your ambition to lead a quiet life, to mind your own business, and to work with your hands, just as we told you, so that your daily life may win the respect of outsiders, and so you will not be dependent on anybody. Amen.
Thanks to Ian for reading that passage of scripture for us. Well, hello kids, good to be able to speak to you. Hope you're all doing well and enjoying school. I'm going to speak to you today about animals, and I'm going to put some animal pictures up on the screen. But before I do that, I just want to say, you know, when you look at the world that God has made all around you, the things that God has created, nature, every plant and every animal has special features. It's all different. God's an amazing craftsman. He makes amazing things that we see all around us, including ourselves. We are fearfully and wonderfully made, as the Lord says in his word. And you know, when you think of certain kinds of animals that God has made, you think of special features that they have. So I want to show you some animals here, and we'll talk about their special features. So there is a cheetah. Okay, that's a big cat. Now, what is it about a cheetah that's special? You may have your own ideas, but I mean, I think most people would say that a cheetah, what's special about a cheetah is how fast it can run. I think it's the fastest land animal. It can run incredibly fast. God made the cheetah to be incredibly fast. So that's one animal. Let's put up another kind of animal, or another little animal. This is another cat, but it's a little cat, and it's a kitten. And what's the special feature of a kitten? Well, all cats have special features, but I suppose for us, a kitten would be its cuteness. You know, God has made things to be cute and adorable, and I suppose a little kitten would be an example of that. So let's try another animal. What's that? That's a giraffe. And what's special about a giraffe? Well, you would probably say that what's special about a giraffe is how tall it is. I think it's the tallest animal. God made the giraffe to be incredibly tall with its incredibly long neck. So we'll go on to the next slide. Whoops, we'll go back, go to him later. Next, what's that? It's a bird of prey. And we see round here, we see red kites. You know, that's not a red kite. I'm not sure what kind of bird of prey. Somebody can tell me. But what's special about a bird of prey? Well, there's lots of things that are special about birds of prey. Their eyesight, incredible eyesight, but also their ability to soar and glide through the air is amazing. When you see the red kites round here gliding, they're so graceful. And finally, you've already had a wee glimpse at him. This boy here, what's that? That's a gorilla. And what special feature is there about a gorilla? Well, I would say when I look at a gorilla, that a gorilla is incredibly strong. God made gorillas to be incredibly strong animals. So all animals have special features. God has made them to be special and to be unique. But God made us human beings to be very special, to be the most special of all his creation. God made us in his image, which means that God made us to know him and to love him. And that's what we were meant to do, to know God, to love God, to be in fellowship with God, to have God as our friend. But because we have sinned against God, we do not know God as we should. And God has set aside a day when he will punish all who do not know him and have sinned against him. And that's why God sent the Lord Jesus to die for our sins, so that we can be forgiven and once again know God and love God and have that blessing of knowing him forever. And Christians, then, those who trust in Jesus as their Saviour, and I want all of you to put your faith in Jesus who died for your sins and know him as your Saviour. Christians, those who trust in Jesus as their Saviour, are meant to have a special feature about them. And that is love, that we love one another. Or brotherly love, as Paul calls it. We're reading a passage, Ian read a passage from 1 Thessalonians 4, and there's a verse. Now about brotherly love, we do not need to write to you. For you yourselves have been taught by God to love each other. In the church, we are meant to show brotherly love to one another, to love each other, because we are all, through faith in Jesus, brothers and sisters in Christ. And so I want you, each of you, to know the love of Jesus, to know the saving power of Jesus to save you from your sins, and the love of Jesus, the forgiveness of God through faith in Jesus, and to know the blessing of being part of the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, because that's a great privilege and blessing, and to love others and to love one another as God has commanded us to do. So thank you very much for listening, and we're going to sing your hymn now. So thank you. In prayer, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the fact that we can worship you this morning, and that we can come into your presence, Lord God, and we can rejoice in Jesus, who is our Saviour and our elder brother, who has sanctified us by his blood and brought us together as a fellowship of those who are redeemed from sin and death. And we thank you, Heavenly Father, that you incorporate us through faith in Christ into the family of believers, the household of faith, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we thank you for all of the privileges and blessings that we receive and are promised to us through Christ our Saviour. And we remember this morning, and we pray, Heavenly Father, for all of those not well among us, those who are in hospital, those who are receiving treatment, those who are struggling with ill health. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you would put your hand of healing and blessing upon them, and that you would be with them and with their families at this time. We continue to remember and pray for our government at this time, that you would give them help and wisdom in dealing with this current pandemic. We pray, Lord God, for our doctors and our nurses and NHS staff, that you would strengthen them and be with them at this time and help them as they continue to deal with this situation. We pray, Heavenly Father, for ourselves as congregations in Drumgooland and Kilkenamurray, that you would continue to be with us as we worship in the midst of these current restrictions, that you would bring us back together soon again, Lord, in our buildings. And we pray, Father, that you would sustain us by your word and by your spirit. And we pray for our wider church, for the Presbyterian Church in Ireland, that you would be with the leadership of the church and our denomination, and that you would just help them to continue to have wisdom to work through these difficult times and circumstances. And we pray, Lord God, that you would help us, each of us as believers, to live lives that are orderly, lives that glorify Christ our Savior, lives that are centered upon Christ, lives that are orientated towards heaven and towards the glory which is to come, rather than the fading glories of this age. And so, Lord God, we pray all of these things through and in the name of Jesus our Savior. Amen. So we come now to our Bible passage that Ian read for us earlier, and just want to spend a few moments looking at this passage, 1 Thessalonians 4 and verses 9 to 12. So we'll just have a look at this passage. Let's put some PowerPoints up on the screen there, if we can do that. There we go. Successful organizations need and have a code of conduct. All major companies and corporations and businesses these days have a code of conduct. A code of conduct, I suppose, really defines how a company's employees should act on a day-to-day basis. It reflects the organization's core values and, I suppose, you would say, the overall company culture. A code of conduct is important as a guideline for everybody that's involved in the business or corporation. And it also it's a means of giving people a sense of identity and sort of core values. And the short passage that Ian read to us earlier is one in which Paul sets out for us as believers a divinely given code of conduct. Last week we saw how Paul presents us with instructions concerning holiness. In this little section, verses 1 to 12 of chapter 4 of 1 Thessalonians, is really a section of the letter in which he is addressing issues of Christian behavior. But last week we saw how Paul presented us with instructions concerning holiness and the need for moral purity. And in these last few verses of that section, verses 9 to 12, he sets out our defining core value, brotherly love, and a practical code of conduct for believers. The Apostle Paul really, I suppose, he really deals with then these two areas of Christian behavior in these verses. Brotherly love and the necessity for believers to live an orderly life as a testimony to those who are outside of the church. And these two issues are vital for the life of the church. This is not merely some sort of, you know, add-on instruction by Paul or some sort of ad hoc teaching by Paul. What he is speaking of here is, in Paul's mind, and according to the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, necessary for the life of the church. And so we need to pay attention, close attention, to what he is teaching us here and what he is saying here. So first of all, Paul speaks of the necessity for brotherly love. It is possible that there may have been some tension in the Thessalonian church which motivated Paul to mention this topic of brotherly love, although generally speaking, the Thessalonian church appears to have been faithfully living out Paul's teachings. And that's borne out by the fact that, you know, he really gently reminds them here of the need for continuing and increasing brotherly love. The word that's translated brotherly love is the Greek word Philadelphia or Philadelphia. We will all be familiar with the word Philadelphia as the name of the largest city in Pennsylvania, USA. There was also an ancient city in Asia Minor called Philadelphia, which is mentioned actually in the book of Revelation, chapter 3 and verses 7 to 13. And the Apostle John addresses that church, the church in Philadelphia, in Revelation chapter 3. But the word Philadelphia, although it is was used as a name for an ancient city and a modern city, the word Philadelphia was a word used in everyday speech in ancient Greek, which simply means brotherly love. And it, I suppose, in its everyday and ordinary usage, the word Philadelphia, which Paul uses here, referred to the love that members of a family, a same family unit, would have for each other or towards each other, would express towards each other. And there is an emphasis in the use of the term, the ordinary meaning and use of the word Philadelphia, on solidarity and harmony between people. Siblings, brothers and sisters, parents and children were expected to support and care for each other in a bond of family or familial or brotherly love. Indeed, ancient people generally saw friendship between people who were not of the same household as being a kind of reproduction or imitation of the natural bonds of affection that exist within a family. The family unit was the central building block of the ancient world. And so when Paul speaks here of brotherly love between believers and its importance, and he really does emphasize its importance, he is speaking openly about this new relationship that exists between believers as a new family. Believers, those who have come to saving faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and are redeemed by the blood of Christ, are now brothers and sisters through their common faith in Christ. And I think it's important to point out that, you know, Paul and other scripture writers see the church in this way. They see the church as a family. We tend to see the church in this day and age. We see the church in terms of structures and sort of leadership roles and programs and policies. And of course, it's important that we have structure in the church, and the apostolic church had structure and it had leadership authority, which is set out for us in scripture and which is divinely given and is necessary. But in his ordinary dealings with believers, Paul generally sees them as brothers and sisters. And he saw the church in terms of household or family. Indeed, it was natural as well for ancient people to view the church in this way. It was a natural way of thinking for them. You know, we live in a world of individualism on the one hand, and corporations and institutions and, I suppose, big government on the other hand. You know, with all these complex management structures and specific leadership roles and strategies. But in the ancient world, the fundamental unit in society was the household or the family. And while the Roman Empire had its structures and was highly organized, the basic unit of the ancient world was the household. And so in the purposes of God through the inspired writings of the Apostle Paul, the church is revealed to us as a new family, as a household, as Paul says in Galatians 6 and verse 10, he says, or he describes the church, he describes believers and the church as the household of faith. So the church of Thessalonica, who Paul is writing to here, would have been composed of a diverse mixture of people from different cultural backgrounds. There would have been Jews, Greeks, Romans, barbarians. They would have also come from different social backgrounds and classes. Those who were wealthy alongside those who were poor, those who were slaves alongside those who were free men. But what now binds them all together is the fact that they are, through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, born into a new family and have a new family identity. And regardless then of their cultural background or their social status, they share this new identity, made very real to them, you know, as they shared the same cup of fellowship around the table. And what was paramount to their life together as believers in this new household of faith was brotherly love. In the same way that the members of the same family care for each other and look after each other because they belong to each other, seeing each other as the same because they are part of the same family unit, so believers are to see each other then as members of this new spiritual and eternal family, the family of God in Christ. Indeed, not only are we commonly referred to as brothers in the New Testament, but Christ is referred to in Hebrews as our brother. You might say our elder brother. Hebrews 2 and verse 11. For he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one source. That is why he is not ashamed to call them brothers. And so Christ is revealed to us as our brother. And brothers are to live in brotherly love. Paul declares here that he has no need to write any detailed instruction about brotherly love, perhaps because in part they were doing so well in this regard, but also because, as he states here, he says, you yourselves have been taught by God to love each other. They have been taught this brotherly love by God. Brotherly love is something that is taught to them by God. It is, the word Paul uses here is theodidaktos, taught to them by God. And so brotherly love is something that is taught to all true believers by God. And what does that mean? You know, what does it mean to be taught brotherly love by God? That word theodidaktos, taught by God, is only ever used here in the whole of Scripture. So it's challenging to ascertain what exactly Paul means by it. You know, when you have a word that's used in other places in Scripture, you can reference those uses of the word and work out and be helped from that concerning the meaning and use of the word or the term. But this term theodidaktos is only ever used here. Well, I think there's a couple of important points to make here about what Paul means in saying that the believers are taught by God brotherly love. First of all, the great command of Jesus given to the disciples and by extension to you and me, to all believers, which is found in John 13 and verse 34, is that what he says is this. He says, a new command I give to you, that you love one another, just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. Jesus himself gave us this command concerning brotherly love, which was in turn taught by the apostles to the church and is found generally in Scripture. So, loving one another and brotherly love has a divine source, namely Christ. But also, the command to love is impressed upon our hearts by the Holy Spirit. All believers, through salvation, are endowed with the Holy Spirit. And the command to love is impressed upon our hearts by the Holy Spirit who is present with us, who teaches us and enables us to love one another through our being in fellowship with Christ, who has first loved us. We are born anew through salvation. Our hearts are characterized then by a new love, which is given to us by the Holy Spirit and flows to us from Christ. So we are given a new heart and a new ability to love through salvation and the presence of the Holy Spirit within us. And that's something that was actually prophesied, that through the new covenant which is established with us by God, by the blood of Christ, his people, God's people, will be given a new heart. That's why I read Jeremiah 31 earlier at the start of our worship. Jeremiah 31 verse 33, "For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts." Through the salvation of Christ, we have the law of God, which is, as we know, fulfilled through love, written upon our hearts. And so, through having a new heart and the presence of the Holy Spirit within us, we love one another. And so as believers, we ought to pray for this reality and seek for it in our own lives, for the expression and presence and reality of brotherly love in our fellowship in Drumgooland and Kilkenny, and the presence and reality of love in our hearts and in our lives. And our church congregations are families that care for one another with brotherly love, demonstrating the new heart that is meant to be found in us through faith in Christ, hearts of love and tenderness. And I suppose the Thessalonians, you know, they were doing well in this regard, but Paul says that he wants them to increase more and more in this, and he wants us to do the same. It's not a static thing, it's a dynamic, it must be something that is increasing in us. And they are doing well. They are caring for each other. They are loving each other. As Paul says here, throughout Macedonia, they are known by other churches and believers for their brotherly love, the Thessalonians. This expression of brotherly love, which is known throughout Macedonia, had to be practical for it to be known. So it probably took the form of practical aid and support to neighbouring churches. Also, Thessalonica was a metropolitan commercial hub within the Roman province of Macedonia. And no doubt the Thessalonian Christians showed hospitality to other believers from other parts of Macedonia who were travelling through Thessalonica. But the point is that they provided practical help and support, and that's what brotherly love really is in terms of its outworking. It is care, not just a sentimental feeling, but actual care, concern for other believers. And that's what these believers were doing in Thessalonica. They were practicing this, providing practical help and support, which is described here as brotherly love. And so brotherly love, and this is another point to make about it, is also outward. It is outward facing as well as inward facing, because they not only practice brotherly love amongst each other, but they demonstrated it and practiced it outwardly towards other churches and other believers. And so, our help, and a point to make from that, is our help and support for other Christians is very important. The fact that we in Drumgooland and Kilkenny support Christian charities is important, and I know is greatly appreciated by those who receive support from us. And I suppose here is an exhortation to us, let's not forget that work and ministry in the midst of our present difficulties. I know in Kilkenny, the wee envelopes have to go in for a tear fund. Don't forget about that. This is an important way of expressing brotherly love. The second point that Paul makes here is to do with our manner of life. He says, make it your ambition to lead a quiet life, to mind your own business, and to work with your hands, just as we told you. Paul wants believers to embrace the values of restraint, respect, and diligence. And Paul has in mind then that issue of how our character manifests itself to those outside the church, to unbelievers. He says that we are, and literally to quote it or translate it, we are to aspire to live quietly. And that word translate, make it your ambition or aspire, seems to have been a word that was used at that time for people who had vain aspiration, people who wanted to gain glory and honor for themselves through self-serving public displays of good works and generosity, but to bring glory to themselves. And Paul takes the word and kind of turns it on its head. And he says that we should aspire, our ambition as believers should be simply to live quiet, humble, and unassuming lives. And he combines quietness with the warning that we should also mind our own business. That might be a general command not to be nosy. I think it is. But it probably also has the greater meaning of saying that believers should stay out of controversial affairs and disputes. It has a sort of public ring to it, the phrase. And while it's good for Christian people to be involved in politics and in public life, it's not good for Christians to become unnecessarily, and I underline the word unnecessarily, involved in other people's quarrels or to needlessly take sides in controversial issues. Our eyes, why? Because our eyes are meant to be heavenwards. We're meant to know better and to be above that kind of thing. Our eyes are meant to be heavenwards, living in the reality that salvation and the truth of the gospel is the great issue facing people. And honoring the Lord is the main goal of life. We have something as believers greater to focus on than the quarrels and disputes of this age. Paul also commands here he says, work with your own hands. He's speaking here of the importance of diligence and supporting ourselves wherever that is possible. In the ancient world, and this is probably what he has in mind here to give it a specific context, in the ancient world there was a kind of system of patronage whereby wealthy patrons would support poor citizens by giving them food and clothes, coinage, money, representing them if they got into trouble in exchange for their loyalty. And the dependent person would then get these benefits on the understanding that they would give public honour and recognition to their wealthy patron and provide him with special attention and support in public meetings and on public occasions. And obviously that system of patronage was very open to corruption and encouraged dependency and flattery. And Paul doesn't want any of that kind of thing in the church or to be brought into the church. And I suppose, you know, to bring this to us and to apply it to us, what Paul is saying here is that wherever it is possible, believers should support themselves, be diligent, live lives that are that avoid unnecessary dependency, and that through living our lives in this way, through diligence, we bring honor to Christ and we bring glory to the name of Christ in the world around us. And so when we live ordinary lives that are characterized by orderliness and restraint and respect and diligence, we bring honor to our Savior, who has redeemed us by his blood. Christ himself exemplifies this for us. He was wholly restrained in his life, living only to please his heavenly Father. He was wholly focused on the mission that his heavenly Father had given to him, and through diligent and relentless labor, he accomplished his mission. And the Lord Jesus has, through his perfection, purchased us from sin and judgment by his blood shed for us on the cross, and he wants us to honor him with our lives through living orderly and diligent lives. To live lives that are quiet, restrained, respectful, and diligent is a blessed way of living. And it is God's will for us. It also wins the respect of those who are outside of the church. So let's aim then, as the people of God in Christ in Drumgoolan and Kilkenamurray, let's aim with prayer and with God's mercy to live excellent lives, both within the church in terms of brotherly love, and outside of the church in terms of living lives that are orderly and diligent. And if we do this, we will have a much more effective testimony of Christ as our Lord and Savior. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your grace and for your mercy. And we thank you, Lord God, that you are with us in the midst of all the different aspects of our lives. Work, family, neighborhood, church. We pray, Lord God, that we would, through your help and by the enabling of the Holy Spirit, be able to live lives which are orderly and lives which are God-honoring, to bring glory to Christ. And so, Father, we pray these things through and in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. So we're going to sing our final item of praise now. This is a recording from, it's actually a joint Drumgoolan and Kilkenamurray choir anthem, The Power of Your Love. So we'll worship the Lord together. now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen.